Amen. Welcome tonight. Glory to God over this broadcast, over this video tonight. As we wake up, you sleepyheads, as we wake up the Samuels tonight, as we shift the atmosphere tonight in this video, through this broadcast, co-laboring, partnering with the Lord. In Jesus' name, we welcome you. We welcome you on this broadcast tonight. Father God, we pray over every soul, every person that is tuning in right now. We ask in Jesus' name that you loose chaos that may be in the households right now, that things that are happening behind the scenes, if there's any dysfunction that's happening behind the scenes, Lord, we ask you to usher in your presence of Holy Spirit and reign into the homes tonight. In their homes tonight. Anybody on here that may have a headache, that may have a headache or fogginess in the head, please put it in the comments, because that really got, it was 7:58 and boom, I just got hit with a cloud of headache, and I know it's not mine. So if you're on the other end, I just want to pray with you. It's a nice little word of wisdom from the Lord. So even in this replay, if you're getting on, we'll just pray over that right now, that in the name of Jesus, Father God, we usher in the presence of the Holy Spirit, and your word says that you heal all who come to you. So we're coming to you right now at your altar, Lord, for sickness, disease, any discomfort, headache specifically, we speak to you. And we command you loose. We command you loose off the viewer, off the people that are in your group, the children of God. We command the headache loose in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, we ask you to usher in into that place of fogginess that may reside in somebody's head right now, because the headache leaves like this fog. So Holy Spirit, we ask you, we command an ushering in of the presence of God within that sphere of their mind, Lord, that you just reign, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. So tonight I'm going to ask you, hello, G, hi, nice to see you. Hello, Kathy, Jeff, welcome. Welcome tonight. It's so good to see all of the mighty warriors of Christ on here. And I'm going to ask you to go ahead and get your Bibles ready and turn to 1 Samuel chapter 3. And we are going to be waking the sleeping Samuels tonight on this broadcast, because the Lord really spoke to me through the week. And I really felt him saying that I am talking to my children. Many of them are sleeping. Many of them are really busy. Many of them are not understanding that it's me talking to them. They don't know which way to go. They don't know their left from the right. And these are my kids. And he wants you to know how to minister to him, how to present yourself to him as a holy sacrifice, to be on the receiving end, all right, to be on the receiving end for the glory and the goodness of God. Hello, Suzanne, nice to see you. Pamela, it's nice to see you too. And so before we dive into the book of 1 Samuel, I'm going to give you a little bit of background about Samuel, all right? Samuel was a foster child to Eli. Okay, in that time, he would have been a foster child. Many people think Samuel was a child of Eli's, but he wasn't. Okay, Eli had children, and the children that Eli had bore blasphemed against God. They became priests, believe it or not, but in their priestlyhood, they were blaspheming against God. And God takes care of Eli and his family in a way that we wouldn't want God to take care of us. But Eli's sons was sleeping with female assistants outside the temple. They were stealing money from the money bag that belonged to the church. And all of these things were going on. And God brings judgment on Eli and his family. But in the meantime, in the interim, he sends Samuel to Eli. And he has Eli train Samuel up, okay, train Samuel up to minister to the Lord as a servant to the Lord. Now, during this time that Eli has these sons and all of his sons are misbehaving, he actually was honoring his sons in the middle of them doing all of the things that the Lord was rejecting, and he was being blasphemed against, it says in the Bible that Eli actually honored his sons, and he put his sons before God. Okay, and so God passes judgment on Eli and his sons. He brings Samuel in. And the beautiful thing about the story, we're going to go ahead and read it, and then we're going to be waking some sleeping Samuels tonight, and we are going to be implementing what we're reading into our daily lives. Because how many of you know that the Bible is written for us at this time? Okay, it's not just a nice history book to read, but every single word, every bit of penmanship that went to the paper is for us to utilize in our life now, in terms of healing, in terms of restoration, in terms of receiving, in terms of giving out, freely receive, freely give is what the Lord says. So everything that you will be feeding off tonight, the fresh manna that you will be receiving tonight from the Lord, just so that you can go out and further the kingdom on earth, whether it's within in your workplace, within your family, there's not a job that is not significant to the Lord. You do not have to be a pastor or a preacher to hold, you know, high regard with the Lord. Everybody on the platform and on a playing field has significance on earth right now. So we're going to be commanding, commissioning, petitioning in the name of Jesus through this video. So nestle in, be on the receiving end. And in the name of Jesus right now, Father God, we usher you in, Holy Spirit. We usher you into this presence. We usher you into the presence if there's any turmoil in anybody's life. We usher you in. We usher you in right now in the name of Jesus. We ask you, Lord, to intertwine with people on the other end. Do something really, really significant from glory to glory. Take people to new levels with you, a new level of intimacy. And in Jesus' name, we pray right now. We command deaf ears open and blind eyes to see areas of goodness of our Lord Jesus Christ that have never been sought out before. Amen. Okay, so Samuel, he's a small boy, a foster child that comes in under Eli, and he begins ministering to the Lord. John 14:18, you don't have to go there, stay at 1 Samuel, but John 14:18 says, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. So I want you to understand that we're talking about Samuel who's a foster child, who was an orphan, okay? And God sought him out. That's what the Holy Spirit does. God seeks you out. For the person that you have been praying for, maybe it's been for months, maybe it's been for years, know that God is seeking them out as well. Okay, many times we're in the prayer, and in our prayer we say, you know, Lord, we pray that this person seeks you. We pray that that person seeks you. And that's fine. That's great. But the Bible says that the Holy Spirit seeks. Okay, that the Holy Spirit draws the person to the Lord. So many times when I'm talking with the Lord, I will ask the Lord, Lord, I command in the name of Jesus that you expedite this process, that we expedite the lost sheep, that we bring these lost sheep, bring them into the fold, or the people that were once with you in the name of Jesus, that you expedite. It's almost like a delivery, right? Like a FedEx delivery, but we're delivering them in the hands of Jesus so that they can have freedom and they can have salvation. So you can expedite the process through your prayers. Remember, everything runs through your prayers. God does nothing without prayer and everything through it. So you can command in the name of Jesus to expedite the process of the person that you were praying for that you know is lost and needs the Lord. Okay? And so I'm going to go ahead and leave that with you right now, that we expedite the process on this broadcast of everybody who is holding a burning heart for a lost soul, a burning heart for someone who has not found the Lord yet, or they found the Lord and they walked away from the Lord. Father God, Holy Spirit, we ask you right now, you know the names of all the people on this video that is holding this in their heart. We ask you to expedite the process of you going to seek them out, that they yield to your Holy Spirit, that you soften their hearts, that you remove pride and arrogance from people, Lord, that you just remove it. May your mighty hand of God strongly move from heaven to earth and just pull out that very thing that pulls people people away from your call. Open their ears, Lord, so that they can clearly hear you like Samuel did. So they can clearly hear you like Samuel did. Lord, we ask you for visitations to these people, whether it's in a dream, whether it's in a vision, whether it's through music, some form or fashion, Lord, that they clearly hear your voice. In Jesus' name, Lord, amen. Psalms 146:9, the Lord watches over the foreigner, sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the wicked. He sustains the fatherless and the widow, and he will frustrate the wicked. Okay, and that's what happened with Eli and his sons. So let's go ahead and let's go to 1 Samuel, and we're going to do a little bit of reading together. And I want you to see how Samuel is positioned in this story that is shared with us in the Bible, where he's at in his mind, where he's at in his heart, where Samuel is physically. And I'm going to lay a platform for you. I'm going to just like lay a foundation to build off of. I gave you a narrative of the story of where Samuel's from, the background of Eli and his sons, the judgment that is coming to Eli, okay? So you have that. Now we're going to read it, but I'm giving you a narrative so that you can understand God's word clearly, okay? I love that. I love getting narratives. It's like watching, before a movie, right? It's kind of like watching before a movie. Here's key points that I want you to either take a note of or just put it on the shelf as we're reading the story of Samuel. I want you to recognize that Samuel, this foster child, okay, that is from abandonment, that now is resting under Eli, the priest, okay, who is being judged on for wrongdoing, all right? He's at a place of peace and rest. He's coming from that type of background. He landing himself in the temple. Okay. Hi, Elizabeth. Welcome. Nice to see you. Nice to see you, dear. He landed himself in the temple. All right. Which is a place of peace, a place of rest. And he's not only physically there, but he's mentally there as well. And you're going to see that in the story. He's ministering to the Lord. He is ministering to the Lord. And as he's ministering to the Lord, he had not yet even met the Lord yet, but he's doing it anyway. All right, so keep that on your shelf. He heard the Lord's voice in the story, and he doesn't recognize the Lord's voice, which is why God has ushered in this discussion tonight, because I felt strong in my spirit that God is saying that the people that are ministering to me, Michelle, they're singing my praises in church, okay? They're hanging out with me in my holy word, still don't know my voice. They still don't know my voice. And you're going to know it by the end of this video. Samuel was not there to receive anything. He was just there doing what he was called to do. And ministering to the Lord. He was told to listen and he just did it. He was obedient to those who were in a higher rank than him, even though he's a child. He wasn't rebellious. He was obedient to those who gave instruction to do something. And he does not withhold a prophetic word when the Lord gives it to him. All right, that's a lot of stuff that I just gave you. I hope that you took note on it, because now we're going to read the story and we're going to unpack this a little bit. But God is calling you, saints. He's calling you to understand that you have a royal priesthood as child of God. That is in the book of Peter. You guys have a royal priesthood, and I'm going to read that to you really quick, so that you have such a clear understanding of the story. 1 Peter 2:5. You also, like having stones, are being built into a spiritual house. You're being built into a spiritual house. You house, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You house him. Holy Spirit is a he. He's not an it. He's a he, he's a him, okay? You replaced the Ark of the Covenant, okay? You house the Holy Spirit. 1 Peter 2:5. Like having stones are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. You are a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. You offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ, through this new covenant with the Lord. Stand up and walk and put away your walker. Jeff, I didn't see the post. I'll have to read it. You are a royal priesthood. Samuel is entering this royal priesthood. You are a royal priesthood. It is my desire, I know it's God's desire, to burn in your heart, to burn and ingrate in you the value of you. The value of you. Your partnership and co-laboring with the Lord and its utter importance here on earth. You are saints. You are children of God. You are heirs of a heavenly dynamic kingdom. And you are heirs of a royal priesthood. 1 Peter makes this clear to the people because the priests had to have special favor to go behind the veil, to go behind that curtain. And we know that curtain has torn from top to bottom, from heaven to earth. We no longer have that veil that we have to go through. By the grace of God, we automatically get to come straight in and act as priests. But listen to what 1 Peter says. He says, offering sacrifice. That means we are ministering to the Lord. You guys are going to get this because a big part of this broadcast is to teach you how to minister to the Lord. Not just receive the Lord, not just receive from Him, but minister to Him. Something dynamic happens as we minister to the Lord. We minister to Him. I remember I actually was sitting at a church service. This was many years ago. And the pastor from the pulpit, I'll never forget this, he said that we don't need to minister to the Lord. He has all the angels in heaven doing that. And I was like, what? Wait, what did you just say? And I'm hoping that I misunderstood and what was said and what was heard. I pray that they were two different things. But the Lord, the Bible clearly shares that He loves to be ministered to. We're going to get to 1 Samuel, but just hear me out on this ministering. The importance of ministering to the Lord. Acts 13:2, the book of Acts, when you read the movement and the Pentecostal movement and the fire, you know, coming on the disciples, they were busy ministering to the Lord. Okay, Acts 13:2, while they were worshiping the Lord, they're worshiping Him, okay, and while they're doing it and they're fasting, another form of ministering to the Lord is fasting. Denying your flesh offers a sacrifice in the supernatural, a burning incense almost, if you will, that every time you make a fleshy sacrifice on His behalf, you are ministering to the Lord. Therefore, every time you deny your flesh over and over and over, you make room, saints, you make room for open ears to hear the Lord. Acts 13:2, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, so notice, while they were worshiping and they're fasting, the Holy Spirit said, so that tells me they were able to hear God's voice. It said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul. Holy Spirit tells them, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. So after they fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them out. Holy Spirit spoke in the middle of a worship and a fast. This Saul that is being talked about is Paul, who wrote all of the epistles in the Bible. This is through the laying on of hands, through worshiping, which is ministering to the Lord, okay, and fasting, they were able to hear the Holy Spirit's voice, lay hands on Paul, and we all know what Paul did, right, in the Bible, okay? He wrote, you know, half the New Testament. a mighty movement. It changed history. It changed history because they were ministering to the Lord. It's one thing to listen to a song being sung and enjoy it for your heart's fulfillment. But it's another thing to flip the pancake over, so to speak, and be the one that says, Lord, I'm here. Lord, I'm here. I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. I'm for you. I'm thankful for you. I'm grateful for you. And you just come in that place of surrender and fast. Okay, many need breakthrough right now in many areas of their life, whether it's be in sickness, whether it would be like in this really dreary place that one might be. And when you put fast with ministering to the Holy Ghost, to ministering to Jesus, okay, you can see a mighty movement going from glory to glory to glory. Many people get healed through ministering and fasting, especially when you are housing the presence of the Holy Spirit on you in such a way that it is a tangible presence. It's one thing to, everybody has the Holy Spirit in them when they were baptized in Jesus, but not everybody has the Holy Spirit upon them when they go out and minister. Okay? Having the Holy Spirit upon you is one thing. Having the Holy Spirit in you is another. And that's a whole nother Bible teaching, Bible lesson. And we did teach it last summer when we studied the gifts of the Spirit. But the reason why I'm bringing this to light to you is when you do this, you allow the overflow of what you have received in your time alone with the Lord to pour out on the lives of others. You allow what you have received from the Lord to pour out onto the lives of others. Now, I'm going to talk to you just from personal experience. That when I'm in a fast, I fast 3 or 4 days a week, every week, okay? When I don't do it and go out and pray for somebody in public or wherever, you know, the Lord wherever brings them, I see a mighty difference in the flow of the Spirit. I do see a difference even in the healings. I just do. You know, it's not a mental thing. There is something about the Holy Spirit's presence on you and the overflow of the presence through the saints, through the sacrifice while ministering to the Lord. Believe and walk now with authority and faith. Hello, everyone. Sorry, I'm late. Hi, Daisy Pearl. Welcome. Welcome, welcome. Okay, so here we go. We're there. All right, we're going to go into 1 Samuel. If you are just tuning in, and I'm not talking to Daisy Pearl, but if you are just tuning in, please go back and play the replay, because the foundation that was laid for the building of the house we're going to be built is a fundamental key part to you getting the fullness and the goodness of this message from our Lord. Okay, Father God, right now I ask you that every single word that is spoken through me is straight from heaven. Lord, I pray that no word falls to the ground, that no word falls to the floor, that every word flows and penetrates into the hearts of man, that your word, that your truth is a double-edged sword, dividing spirit and soul right now in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 3. You all ready? Here we go. We're diving in. We're swimming now. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. Now, we talked about what ministered before the Lord means. So hold that on your shelf. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. So there was not much of a prophetic flow in that day. So when the Lord shows up, it's a really, really big deal when he shows up. So one night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord where the ark of God was. So they are in, okay, he's a priest, and he's basically sleeping. He's sleeping in the temple courts. And the lamp that is being referred to here, the lamp of God, is referring to the seven lampstands. Okay? They are full oil all night long, and they keep these lamps lit every day, all night, until they run out of oil, which is usually by dawn. So at this time, God has given you a little bit of a peek at what time of day it is, because the lamp of God is still lit. Now, in a prophetic sense, because you know I like to give you what the Bible is saying and a little bit of what it is also saying prophetically, it's also saying the lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord. That also is talking about the lamp, I believe, which is lit inside Eli at this time, because Eli is towards his end of life. Okay, he's old, he's towards his end of his life, and his light will go out. Okay, so prophetically speaking, I feel like there's a little prophetic innuendo there, but the lamp of God is referring to the seven lampstands. Has not gone out yet. Then the Lord called Samuel. Hold on, I'm going to get my notes here. Hold on 1 second. There's something I wanted to tell you. Okay. All right. Then the Lord called Samuel, verse 4. Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me?" But Eli said, "I did not call you. Go back and lie down." So he went back and lay down. Again, the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me?" "My son," Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lay down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. So now we have Samuel, who was ministering before the Lord, it says in verse 1. And at verse 7, it says, now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. Many people know the Lord, okay, but the word of the Lord is not clear and has not yet been revealed. There's that part in the New Testament, I can't think of the verse right now, Jeff or Daisy Pearl or somebody on there, if you know it, but I'm thinking of the verse where Jesus in the New Testament opens their ears for the receiving of all the word. He opens the ears of the disciples. And I believe this is after his resurrection. He opens their ears. And so this is a really, really important segment for us to understand, because the Lord is seeking Samuel. Samuel was ministering before the Lord, okay? And now, right now, he's just now getting to meet him for the first time, okay? You know, Samuel ends up becoming a huge ruler over Israel. He's a mighty man. I'm working for the Lord. He will be the first mighty man after Joshua. So this is a really big introduction of the Lord in Samuel's life as a little boy. Okay, he's just a little boy here. Verse 8. A third time the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel got up, went to Eli again, and said, "Here I am. You called me?" Three times. He hears the voice of the Lord three times. Number 3 is very, very prophetic in the Bible. Okay? The Samuels are rising. Amen, Jerome. Yes. Amen. I believe that. Amen. Three times. Very prophetic in the Bible that God calls him three times. Okay? And we've talked about numeric value in the Word of God, the number three. I believe we talked about the number three at length of the last video. Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boys, so Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Notice that what Samuel was doing. He's in a place of rest. He's in a place of peace. There's no distraction. There's no chaos in this temple. It's in a perfect place where he can hear the Lord. Okay? This is a parallel to our lives today. To get our homes, the places where we reside, in a place of peace, in a place of rest. Okay, so that when we are alone in a private time with the Lord in our closet, we can hear him clearly. We can hear him clearly. Verse 10, the Lord came and stood there. Can you even imagine? The Lord came. It didn't say an angel came. It says the Lord. The Lord came and stood there, calling as at the other times. Now he calls his name twice, not once, but twice. He says, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Father God, we thank you that you are calling people in this video tonight by name. We ask you, Lord, that you not call them once, but you call them twice, that you call them three and four times. Lord, I command that the response on the other end is, "Lord, here I am. Here I am. Use me, send me, further your kingdom. Open the territory, Lord. Open, 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 open. Split it open, Lord, during this broadcast. In Jesus' name, amen." Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Verse 11, and the Lord said to Samuel, see, Jesus talking, listen, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears about it tingle. At that time, I will carry out against Eli everything I spoke against his family. God is getting ready to do judgment on Eli, all of his sons, for sleeping with all those women, from stealing from the church, the priests. Okay, these are priests. Even his sons became priests, and they were living ungodly, blasphemy lives before the Lord. Verse 13, for I told him that I would judge his family forever because of the sin that they knew about. His sons blasphemed God, and he failed to restrain them, meaning he failed to discipline his family. Very serious business in the kingdom, very serious. Therefore, I swore to the house of Eli, the guilt of Eli's house will never be atoned for by sacrifice or offering. Now notice, our sin is atoned for today, okay? Especially when we turn away from the sin and we're not deliberately doing it over and over. Okay? These people are deliberately blaspheming God and not repenting. Okay? Thank God we have holy repentance today, but it is to, you know, sin no more. Confess your sins, walk away, and sin no more. Very important. That's a whole nother topic that I could get on a rabbit trail, but we're gonna stay here. Verse 14, therefore I swore to the house of Eli, the guilt of Eli's house will never be atoned for by a sacrifice or an offering. Samuel lay down until morning and then opened the doors of the house of the Lord. He was afraid to tell Eli the vision, but Eli called him and said, Samuel, my son. And Samuel answered, here I am. Now remember this. He was afraid to deliver the word of the Lord to Eli. I want you to remember that. What was it he said to you? Eli asked. Do not hide it from me. May God deal with you, be it ever so severely, if you hide from me anything he told you. So Samuel told him everything, hiding nothing from him. Then Eli said, he is the Lord, let him do what is good in his eyes. The Lord was with Samuel as he grew up, and he let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. Why? Because he was obedient. Okay, he was obedient. He let none of his words fall to the ground, meaning that every word that he said, people heard it, people listened, it pierced people's hearts, they retained it, there was retention, nothing fell to the ground. It went straight to the hearts of the people. And all of Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord. The Lord continued to appear at Shiloh, and there he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. And Samuel's word came to all of Israel. Now, I want you to go back to 15. Verse 15, Samuel lays down until morning, okay? And then he opens the doors of the house of the Lord. He opens the doors of the house of the Lord. What does God tell us about doors in the Bible? Okay, when he presents a door for us to walk through, I find it very prophetic, very significant that Samuel is opening the doors that morning to the house of the Lord. It's recorded in the Bible because now Samuel is about to walk through a brand new door, a brand new entry, this brand new thing he's doing with the Lord. He received a word from the Lord and he delivered it. Many a times we receive a word from the Lord and we don't walk in obedience and deliver what we know that the Lord has put on our hearts. And Eli tells Samuel, you know, may God basically punish you for holding the word. And Samuel tells him everything. He tells him everything. I would rather walk in obedience to a word that is on my heart and in my mind in the fear of the Lord and be wrong, okay, than to hold it in. And this actually happened to me at Kathy Snyder's church on Sunday. I thought that I had a word for the pastor. And I delivered it to him. And he said, I don't think that's me. And I said, well, I know it's someone. I know that I know. But I couldn't find the person. I didn't feel the person was brought to me. So I got to go and pray about it. But it's okay. It's okay to miss it. Okay. It's better to miss it than it is to not say it. Amen. So if the Lord has put something on your heart, you know, genuine for somebody to edify them, to build them up. In this particular word, while I was sitting in church, I kept getting this pain in my neck. And I felt like that it was either the pastor or the wife. Because as I was getting it, I had this interaction, you know, with his wife in front of me. Just all this stuff was happening. And who knows, maybe she went home and maybe something happened at home. I don't know. So I just prayed in my private time about the situation. My point being is if you have a word for the Lord, you know, it might not even be that. It might even be something that is in your spirit stirring and the Lord is telling you, talk to them about me. Mention me. Mention the word love, you know, ease into it. Like maybe like your conscience is stirring about a situation. And those are just like little words and little innuendos from the Lord of words of knowledge for you to march forth, open up those doors, walk through, okay, and just walk in obedience and trust in him that he's going to take care of the word because, you know, the words that he gives you, he doesn't want them to fall to the ground. He doesn't want them to fall to the ground. And so I'm believing through this broadcast, he's raising up Samuels to hear his voice. And so Luke chapter 1, verse 23, I want to bring this to your attention. Luke chapter 1, verse 23, when his time of service was completed, he returned home. Now, in this particular verse, we're talking about Zechariah. We're going to shift gears here. And we're going to talk about Zechariah because he's a priest, all right, like Eli, ministering in the temple. And he's received a message from the angel Gabriel that Sarah is going to have a baby. He receives this message as he's in the temple ministering to the Lord. He gets this message. Okay? Now, it's important that you know this. for a couple of reasons. Now, I'm going to take you to 2 Kings 3:15. And it says, while the harpist played, the hand of the Lord came on Elijah, and he said, blah, 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 blah. I'm not going to repeat it. But while the harpist was playing, the hand of the Lord came on Elijah. 2 Kings 3:15. Elijah calls for a harpist to come play for him because he wants to hear from God. He specifically called for a harpist to play music so that he could minister to the Lord, so that he could hear his voice. All right? How many times have you been in church and the music is playing and you get this beautiful, beautiful stir in your spirit, okay? And your spirit is rocked during praise and worship. You're gathering with all of these other saints. You're ministering to the Lord. Now, what I want to share with you is you don't have to go to church. It's important that you go. I'm not telling you not to go to church. But you can minister to the Lord in the comfort of your home. You are the temple housing the Holy Spirit. Okay? You can usher in the presence of the Lord through your television, through your music at home, through getting down on your hands and knees and asking the Lord, what is it that you want to say to me? A lot of times when I'm ministering to the Lord, I will have my Bible before me as the music is going, and I will just randomly open it. I'm not seeking a certain scripture, and I will say, Lord, speak to me from this page. What is it that you want me to know to deliver to the rest of the world? What is it that you might want me to know personally? And what is it that you want me? And this is how I came to Samuel. It was in the middle of the night at about 3 o'clock in the morning. I will set my alarm intentionally for 3 a.m. to sacrifice sleep to get up to minister to the Lord for an hour and go back to bed. That's just what I do as my personal sacrifice. Everybody does something different, okay? But I'll do that in conjunction with a 4-day fast every single week. And there's just something mighty and beautiful that happens. There's breakthrough that happens within families. There's, you know, I personally have been delivered from, you know, some serious sicknesses. I had so many different autoimmune disorder diseases. I can't even tell you how many I had. Okay, how many pills I was on for ridiculous migraines, and then I was on allergy medicine and Zoloft, and I take nothing. I'm telling you, nothing. And I credit it all to our Lord Jesus Christ, because I know that he's the God that heals, because in the New Testament, he turns nobody away that comes to him for healing. All right. And when you know what you carry and what you house, your worth, your value, and the kingdom, and you continue to seek him in the healing, even if you don't see it, it's working, and you continue to believe it and seek it. And I just refuse to give up, because we know the hand of the Lord and what he's capable of doing. He can do anything. He's God. Okay. It's the prayer of the faith that saved the sick. It's the prayer of the faith that healed the sick, okay? Healed, saved, sozo, okay? That word saved means sozo, mean healed, physically healed. You know, saved for salvation in heaven. It has multiple meanings, not just saved for heaven, okay? So I want you guys to understand this, because this video broadcast is 1 Samuel, Samuel hearing the voice of the Lord. Elijah hearing the voice of the Lord through a harp being played. You know, he's calling for a harpist. Many of the Psalms, when you read the book of Psalms, I will open the book of Psalms in the middle of the night and just read Psalms to the Lord, because many of the book of Psalms is a ministering agent to the Lord. Okay? And so I want to pray with all of you on here that that the glory, that the glory, that the glory that is due from the Lord is going to be falling mightily on you, that is just going to be encapsulating you in this beautiful, beautiful, wonderful cloud of peace, of shalom over every one of you on this broadcast. Psalm 96, 8 through 9. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Okay, come into his courts. Worship the Lord on the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Even the animals worship him. Even the stars worship him. So, Father God, we ascribe to you the glory due your name. We ascribe to you Psalms 96, 8, 9. We ascribe to you, Lord, the glory due your name. We bring an offering and we come into your courts right now in this video, Lord. Usher us in to your courts. Usher us into your courts. Lord, we worship you with splendor of holiness. We tremble before you over all the earth. Lord, usher your saints into this place, into your temple courts, Lord. Teach them how to minister you, to minister to you, to worship you and seek you in that place of intimacy, Lord, where you can reign forever. Lord, we usher you in to drive out darkness and to light lamps, seven lamps. We commission in the oil for the lamps, for the light, the salt of the earth go forth. May the saints on this broadcast and on the replay be the flavor additive to your words that you speak through them. We thank you for this amazing dynamic evening with you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of ministering to you, fasting, praising, worshiping, communion, prayer, and meditation. Communion. You know, saints, you can do communion in your own home. In your own home. I do it every day. I do it every day. Do this in remembrance of me. Why not? Why not remember the body, the blood shed, the body that was broke for you so you could be healed? Every single time I take the cracker, I take the bread, I intentionally snap it in half because it's a reminder of what he did. I snap it in half, and it's almost like, and that's what the Jewish people do, is they break it in half, okay, the two different loaves, on purpose because of his body that has broke for us. So we thank you, Lord, for your old covenant that was made into the new covenant. We thank you for the bow. We thank you for the bow, Lord, the rainbow, the covenant that rests over your people. We usher in your glory presence at this time, your healing over all who are on this broadcast, healing over everybody. We give you all the glory and praise, Lord. We usher in your Samuels. Awake, 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 awake. All of the Samuels, all of the deaf ears, break open, break loose, break free. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. It's a special time tonight, a special time to hang out with you and get to deliver the word of 1 Samuel. But if you got on later on, I'm going to encourage you to go back and play the foundation, the very, very beginning of this broadcast, okay? The very beginning of this broadcast. And I'm going to encourage you to seek what it looks like to minister to God on a whole new level, to minister to him. Seek what that looks like, okay? commune with him, pray with him, but minister to him. Okay, I can't stress that enough. It's not talked about enough at the pulpit. Minister to him. Be the giver, not the receiver. Be the giver. And therefore, you will be blessed abundantly what he empowers you to do and entrusts you with. Amen, saints. I love you so much. I'll see many of you at my house on Thursday, 6:45. You're all invited. So if you're on this broadcast, we meet every Thursday in my house at 6:45 until 9:00. We're in John chapter 5. Okay? So I will see many of you then. You have a great rest of your week. Bye.